Hello, this is one of several modules for the coming week. This one is on transcription, the first component in going from DNA to protein. We'll see in an introductory fashion that there are three main kinds of RNA, messenger, ribosomal, and transfer RNA, that the transcription of any kind of RNA occurs in three steps called initiation, elongation, and termination. We'll learn about promoters, which are the start sites of transcription. We'll look a little bit at prokaryotic and eukaryotic transcription. And I will briefly review for you the kinds of RNA processing that you should have learned about in 150, which includes processing by cleavage, which is to say simply hydrolysis of pieces of unwanted RNA, splicing, the removal of intervening sequences or introns in messenger RNA, and then nucleotide additions or base modifications, the sorts of things that happen with transfer RNAs. So there are three main kinds of cellular RNA: the messenger RNA, the ribosomal RNA, which is part of the ribosome structure, and as you will see, has enzymatic function, independent of polypeptide structure, and then transfer RNA. This is what makes up most of a cell's RNA. Now, you will recall from our discussions of DNA that there are other kinds of RNA, and as an example, primers are a kind of RNA as well, but they and other kinds of RNAs, which we will encounter quantitatively, are not a major component of a cell's RNA. The three major components are shown here. So this is transcription as it would occur in all cells, and the first part, of course, the first step is initiation. And during initiation, well, what we see here, first of all, is a double-stranded DNA, two lines representing two strands of DNA that are to be transcribed. There is a promoter to the left in blue, up and to the right arrow, which represents the start site of transcription. And then this red thing, which is an RNA polymerase. The RNA polymerase binds to the promoter, recognizes the sequence of the promoter, and is thereby positioned at the start site of transcription. Once that happens, it is possible to actually start growing an RNA molecule by elongation, a series of cyclic reactions during which an RNA is actually produced, beginning at the 5' end of the RNA and growing towards the 3' end. The actual chemical reaction is nucleotide monophosphates to the N, which means a partial chain exists with N nucleotide monophosphates, to which is now going to be added the next nucleotide. The precursors are the nucleotide triphosphates, NTPs. Specifically for RNA, those, of course, are ATP, UTP, CTP, and GTP. So one of those is going to be added next based on the base that's in the template strand that's being transcribed. The result will be to create a nucleotide monophosphate chain that is N plus 1 nucleotides. Each new addition is accompanied by the hydrolysis of a pyrophosphate, two phosphates off the end of the nucleotide, as the nucleotide is added to the new chain by a condensation reaction, a dehydration reaction. Not shown here is the fact that water comes out of this reaction. Elongation then just continues 5' to 3' until termination. The RNA polymerase reaches a termination site, at which point the RNA is freed up. You should have seen in this set of animations that the DNA is in fact unwinding during transcription, but that immediately behind the RNA that is being produced, the DNA rewinds. This is a major difference between replication by a DNA polymerase and transcription by an RNA polymerase. During replication, you will recall, once the DNA is unwound and a new strand of DNA is produced, the new strand and the old strand in semi-conservative fashion remain associated. So clearly the RNA does not remain permanently associated with its template strand. It does remain associated for a few nucleotides, but then quickly separates, and so you can see at the bottom of this illustration, most of the RNA is in fact free of any DNA associations. In a double-stranded chromosomal DNA molecule, whether it's bacterial or eukaryotic, genes can face in different directions, which means the template strand can sometimes be, in this example, the upper strand, and sometimes the lower strand. And so we have an illustration of several regions of DNA. Shown in blue are the directions of transcription of different genes, arbitrarily labeled A, B, C, D, and so on. The promoters are shown as little greenish arrows, and I've indicated those in the illustration. So each gene has a promoter, and the promoter faces in the correct direction for the gene to be transcribed. That is to say, it's at the tail end of each of those arrows, in other words. We can separate different RNAs by differences in size, and this is done by something called sucrose density gradient centrifugation. I will describe only briefly how this technique works, but basically you have a tube, it's usually a plastic tube, in which you have set up a gradient of sucrose. Sucrose is highly soluble in water. You can make a sucrose solution that is 20% or even 40% sucrose. That means, for 40%, means you can take 40 grams of sucrose and dissolve it in 100 milliliters of water. That's a very concentrated sucrose solution. And you can make a gradient in which the bottom of the tube has high concentrations of sucrose, and then gradually, as you look at the further and further to the top of the tube, there's less and less sucrose concentration. Under centrifugal force, that is in a centrifuge, an ultracentrifuge, what will happen is a bunch of molecules like this RNA sample here layered on top will move through this gradient and experience increasing resistance to moving towards the bottom of the tube as it encounters sucrose of higher concentration. Under ultracentrifugation, different sizes or different masses of RNA will experience differential resistance. So only the largest RNA molecules will be able to penetrate the highest concentrations of sucrose. So let's see what happens as a result of a centrifugal spin of a tube like this containing a sucrose gradient. So you get a separation of blue material, which in this case represents different size classes of RNA. In the real world, when we do this, it's in a plastic tube, and we puncture the bottom of the plastic tube so that we can drip material out of the tube and collect it in a series of test tubes, which process is called fractionating the gradient. So we've centrifuged at high speed in an ultracentrifuge to effect this size separation, and now we've fractionated the different RNAs that might have separated into tubes, and we can analyze each tube for the amount of RNA that's present. So remember, the material collected from the bottom of the tube right after centrifugation is going to be the larger molecules, and then they get progressively smaller. So now we can take the information about how much RNA is in each tube and plot this on a graph. And what you see here is the plot of a fractionation of total cellular RNA. Well, the top one is bacteria and the bottom one is eukaryotic RNA. And what you see, if you measure the amount of RNA in every tube, so what you have is fraction number or tube number at the bottom in both cases, is that there are three different size classes of RNA in bacteria and eukaryotes. Eukaryotic RNAs are a bit larger, having a larger number, this 28S, 18S, and 4 to 5S, whereas bacteria have RNAs the size of 23S, 16S, and 4 to 5S. The S simply stands for a man's name, Svedborg, who developed the procedure of ultracentrifugation to do this kind of thing. The numbers are a calculation based on the radius of the centrifuge rotor and the position of material in the gradient, so you don't have to know all that. But basically, each band that you saw in the centrifuge tube can be shown to have a certain mass, which is related to this Svedborg unit. So we have 23S, 16S, and 4 to 5S bacterial RNA, and 28, 18, and 4 to 5S eukaryotic RNA. This is RNA extracted from whole cells, without regard to where the RNA might have come from. Okay, so those peaks then represent the blue bands on a gradient. So what kinds of RNAs are these? One way to ask this question is to separate the cell, fractionate the cell, and ask more specifically, what kind of RNA do you find in the cytoplasm? So let's take a look. We'll look at the eukaryotic cell in this case because it has a cytoplasm, it has a nucleus, it has organelles, so it actually has compartments we can ask about. And if you take the cytoplasmic RNA, independent of the nucleus, free of the nucleus, it has the same three size classes as the cell as a whole. What that means is the cytoplasm contains largely these three size classes of RNA. Now, if you remember, ribosomes are made up of proteins and RNAs, and so if we extract ribosomes first and then extract the RNA that was in the ribosomes, in other words, disrupt the ribosomes, throw away the proteins, and have only the RNA, if you run that RNA on a sucrose gradient, you get the same three size classes, 28S, 18S, and 4 to 5S for eukaryotes. But if you do this with bacteria, you take whole bacterial cell RNA, which is in effect the same thing as cytoplasmic bacterial RNA, you see the 23S and the 16S and the 4 to 5S that we saw in the last slide. If you now take ribosomes and fractionate the RNA from those ribosomes and do the same analysis, once again you see the same three different size classes for bacteria, 23S, 16S, 4 to 5S. So what do you conclude from the study? whether it's eukaryotes or prokaryotes. Most of the RNA in a cell is ribosomal RNA. 90% of our cellular RNA is this ribosomal RNA, the RNA that forms a part of this structure, which of course you know is the protein-making machine of the cell. The ribosomal, or rRNA, is part of the ribosome structure. There are two subunits, a large one above and a small one below. And the large subunit in bacteria is made of two RNAs, two ribosomal RNAs, and about 30 proteins. The small subunit is made of one RNA and about 20 proteins. Eukaryotic ribosomes are a bit larger and have a few more proteins and, in fact, one more RNA altogether. Let's take a look at messenger RNA, or mRNA for short. This is messenger RNA associated with a ribosome, busy translating the information in the messenger RNA into a polypeptide, shown here in red. So mRNAs encode proteins and come from genes that encode proteins. Let's take a look at transfer RNA. So here we have the large subunit and the small subunit associated with a molecule of messenger RNA, and a transfer RNA molecule is sitting on this ribosome, exposing an anticodon, which is a three-letter code that is the opposite or complement of a code word for an amino acid, and that anticodon is H-bonding to a code word or codon in the messenger RNA. So I'm relying on you to remember some details about the genetic code, but there's another module coming up that will go into the genetic code in a bit more detail. So the tRNA is there to decode genetic information that was originally in a gene in the DNA that has become transcribed into a messenger RNA and is now being translated by a ribosome into a polypeptide. So prokaryotic transcription and eukaryotic transcription. Prokaryotic transcription is catalyzed by a single RNA polymerase. Bacteria, like E. coli, contain within them a gene that codes for a single polypeptide that is an RNA polymerase. And this RNA polymerase is responsible for transcribing all of the different kinds of RNA, or at least the three major kinds, message, transfer, and ribosomal RNA, in a bacterial cell. Eukaryotic transcription is catalyzed by three different RNA polymerases, RNA polymerases 1, 2, and 3. The RNA polymerase 1 in eukaryotes is responsible for making three ribosomal RNAs, the 28S, the 18S, and then one we haven't seen yet called 5.8S. RNA polymerase 2 is responsible for transcribing messenger RNA, and RNA polymerase 3 is responsible for transcribing transfer RNAs and a fourth ribosomal RNA called 5S. Again, we will revisit these polymerases and their activities in much more detail. So I told you that these different RNAs are most of what a cell has in the way of RNA. So more than 90%, again, is ribosomal RNA, particularly these three. Less than 5%, sometimes less than even 1%, is messenger RNA. And transfer RNA and ribosomal RNA of the 5S size probably together, perhaps about equally, add up to the 5%. So multiple transcription factors help RNA polymerase recognize and bind to the promoter in eukaryotes. So what we're going to see is that a few transcription factors help RNA polymerase in bacteria find where to start transcribing a gene, but that process is much more complex in eukaryotes. Transcription factors then, by definition, must bind to DNA. So they're all binding proteins, and so is RNA polymerase, isn't it? For DNA binding proteins to do something specifically at a particular region of DNA, these proteins have to recognize sequences in DNA that are unique. So here's our model, space-filling model of a bit of DNA showing the major and the minor grooves. And the point of this slide is to remind you that transcription factors have to find sequences of bases. A transcription factor can see the sequence only by looking inside the double helix, that is, in one of the grooves, and mostly through the major groove. So any protein that's going to bind to this DNA to effect transcription, either to help a polymerase bind and do transcription, or for the polymerase itself to bind to a promoter, it's going to see the sequence of the promoter or other specific sequences through one of the grooves, because what's on the outside of the DNA, of course, is just a lot of these red phosphates. So it's another case of shape dictating how things work. Before we end, I want to review for you post-transcriptional processing. Bacterial RNAs, when they are produced by transcription, are pretty much ready to use. They don't undergo any significant alterations or what we call processing. Eukaryotic RNAs, on the other hand, all three of the major ones, are processed pretty extensively before the transcripts are said to be mature, that is to say, ready to function, in the case of rRNA as part of a ribosome, or in the case of transfer RNA to actually interact with a ribosome during translation, and in the case of messenger RNA to be translated. So let's take a look at a summary of the different kinds of transcript processing. It turns out, of course, that mRNA are encoded by split genes, that is, genes that have introns and exons. So the transcript that is made from DNA, shown here with red blocks, is a pre-messenger RNA that then needs to be processed by a splicing. In the DNA, the red blocks are the regions which actually encode, contain the codons for a polypeptide. Therefore, in the transcript, those are the blue blocks. Splicing is getting rid of the white blocks, which don't code for anything, and connecting in correct order the blue blocks. So you end up with a messenger RNA that has the coding sequence for a polypeptide contiguous from one end to the other. mRNAs also undergo some additional processing, which again we'll revisit later. They get a methyl guanosine cap, and this is at the 5' end of the RNA, and they get a poly A tail, consisting here, it says 1 to 200 or more. In fact, most eukaryotes will produce poly A tails of 150 or 200 or more. And only after all this processing and export from a nucleus to the cytoplasm is this a mature messenger RNA ready to associate with ribosomal subunits and to begin being translated. Let's take a look at ribosomal RNA production, at least some of it. RNA polymerase 2 is the polymerase of messenger RNA transcription. So RNA polymerase 1 transcribes ribosomal genes, this particular ribosomal gene, and you get a pre-ribosomal RNA. This RNA undergoes some processing by methylation. And you'll notice that the methylations are in the purple regions, not in the little white regions. That is because the methylation is required in order that enzymes then recognize the border between purple and white, and thereby correctly catalyze the hydrolysis of phosphodiester bonds between RNA nucleotides so that you get correct cleavage. So what happens in this illustration is that you get three pieces of ribosomal RNA, the larger one coming from the left side of the pre-ribosomal RNA, the small one from the middle, and the sort of medium-sized one from the right. Now that accounts for three of the four eukaryotic ribosomal RNA transcripts. So here, finally, are the products of transcription of RNA polymerase 3 in eukaryotes. So there's the DNA. We have a transcript just below that, catalyzed by RNA polymerase 3. And then we have some modifications. Not shown very clearly, although if you look closely, you can see that the pre-RNA here is a little bit longer than the mature RNA. And the little black dots are meant to indicate some base modification. Processing of these RNAs is by some trimming and some base modification. And this is transcription and processing of transfer RNAs. Not shown here, the transcription and processing of the remaining ribosomal RNA, which is also catalyzed by RNA polymerase 3, that is the 5S ribosomal RNA of eukaryotes. I've boxed the mature RNAs at the bottom in green, and I've boxed the RNA polymerases that do the specific catalyses at the top. That brings us to the end of this presentation.